Hi, my name is Stan.
My name is Connie.
My name is Judy.
My name is Aileen, and I'm a caregiver to my mother.
And I care for my mother, Octavia.
And I'm a caregiver for my mother.
And I'm a caregiver to my husband, Art.
I'm a caregiver for my wife, Anne, who's 72 years old.
Basically, I've done everything for providing for both of them.
I take care of my mother on the weekends. I take her grocery shopping.
Not only household chores.
I provide her medical care, coordination, driving, errands.
Choosing meals, making meals, cleaning up.
I find that I take care of anything that he can't take care of.
Sometimes I find balancing time a real challenge.
The difficult part for me is taking me into consideration.
Balancing her needs with the needs of my family, the needs of my marriage, and my own needs.
Staying calm, nice, and positive.
The real challenge is, of course, the distance and the moment you get that last phone call.
What I love most about taking care of her is knowing that we're providing a secure and comfortable home for her.
It's the time we spend together.
Is the adventure of finding out new things all the time to try to help them stay out of pain.
My name is Ed. I'm a spouse and I'm a caregiver.
My name is Colette. I'm a daughter and a caregiver.
I'm a caregiver and I'm a daughter.
And I'm a wife and a caregiver.
I'm a daughter and a caregiver.
I'm a son, a nephew, and a caregiver.
Hi, my name is Deborah Day, and I help manage United Way Caregivers Coalition. While caring for a loved one has its special rewards, it's a very challenging job. It can be stressful, overwhelming, and sometimes lonely. Each caregiving situation is unique, but all caregivers share the need for information and support. And that's where the Caregivers Coalition comes in. We help caregivers receive the support they need to take care of their loved ones and to take care of themselves. Caregivers who lead healthy, productive lives will be better caregivers. The most important thing to remember is that as a caregiver, you're not alone.
Hi. So who's a caregiver in the room? So you come with good credentials. Well, I'm going to start this way. Once you're a caregiver, there's no way out. And the other part to know about that is what you know, and that is the stress of it, the multiplicity of demands on your time and energy. And do you also know, though this is sort of a rhetorical question, because I'm sure you do, that there is such a thing as caregiver burnout?
Yes.
You know it? Mm-hmm. I see a lot of head shaking. And caregiver burnout is not to be ignored, because it is often the caregiver who ends up in the hospital while the person being cared for is fine. So if your blood pressure is high, you know that you are caregiving at a high rate, and you know that you may be overextending yourself. Why do people do this? People come to caregiving because sometimes there's absolutely no choice. Obviously, you've got a family member, you're the one that has to do the care, and maybe you've got supports in your family and maybe you don't, or maybe you think you have supports and maybe you think you don't. And that's among the things that I want to touch on tonight. So the other part of caregiving is, what is underlying it? What happens when all your duties are done? Where are you in that process? And there's also the part of when you're caring for someone, especially chronically ill, what happens over time? And time is a very important factor here. I talk to people all the time about their caregiving responsibilities, and I also talk to people who don't want to think about it. So I talked to recently a woman who said, no, I'm not going to tell my kids what I want. They'll figure it out. And the problem with that is, as you well know, or as I think you know, because you're a bunch of caregivers, so you know this, how do I know what you want? I can guess at it, but I don't really know. You won't have that conversation, so I'm left having to make life and death decisions that we never discussed. And what an uncomfortable position that could be. And stressful. I hear a lot of different things. I see people who are so stressed and so overburdened that they just don't know where to turn. And they're often the people who cycle downward. They don't really know how to get themselves out of it. And so they end up as the people who end up in the hospital, I guess. I talk to children who don't know what their parents want because the parents won't talk to them. We don't think about parents having to care for children, whether they're young children or adult children. But the conversations don't happen because nobody's thinking that a parent will have to take care of a child. So I'm going to tell you a little story. When my son was just about 4 years old, my husband had died. And it was a very difficult time period, as you can imagine. And of course, now he's down one parent. And as we're walking to synagogue this one day, he's about 6 years old now, he's holding my hand, and he said, "Mommy, what would happen if you fell to the ground?" I thought, what an interesting question. And because I'm a social worker, I said, "Well, what do you mean?" Or as we would say in the business, "What do you mean by that?" And what he was trying to get at was, wouldn't know what to do if something happened to you. And what that alerted me to was, people want to know. They don't want to be left in the dark. But when we leave people in the dark and we don't tell them what we want, they are helpless to know what to do except to plow through. Yes, you know a person's wishes pretty well, but then you run into all the things. I run a support group the other night. The one woman was talking about how her mother's condition had changed, and she was so pleased that her mother had been in a place that was taking very good care of her until her mother developed hallucinations. Parkinson's related hallucinations, something she hadn't had before. And the facility, which was a little group home out in western New Jersey, said, "We can't take care of her anymore." And this woman is so stressed out because where are you going to put her now? What kind of facility will take somebody with that condition? And because of a heart condition, she shouldn't be on the medications that might help tamp down the condition. So interesting kinds of problems arise in the lives of caregivers. So caregiver stress and burnout can be rewarding, but I don't want to overemphasize that because in my experience, while I think a lot of people come into it with good faith, good heart, and a willingness to be a good caregiver, it is really tough stuff. And I don't think we should diminish that, and I don't think we should think that just because you're doing a good deed that alone will carry you through. Good deeds can go but so far, especially if you don't know how to do it, how to be a good caregiver. I do believe that there's a way to wrap your brain around how to be a good caregiver that helps you through the process, but I don't think we should neglect the fact that people who say, "This is my mission," really are doing the mission. They're doing what they think they should be doing. Well, we all do that, but you have to remind yourself that at what cost. I think about several different things when I think about caregiving. Also, I think about, who do you have supporting you? Who do you allow in? Who do you allow to help you? Do you go to places like the Caregiver Coalition or to a church or a synagogue or a place of worship to look for help? And when you don't do those things, you do isolate. And the worst part of caregiving is to self-isolate. I think about the ways in which we struggle to keep our lives going. What if you're working? What if you're taking care of little kids? So you're part of that sandwich generation. How do you manage caregiving of a parent? How do you do caregiving when you live far away? How do you care for someone that you never liked? And now you have to take full care of them. I hear a lot of laughter. And they don't get nicer.
No.
They don't get nicer. I work currently with a guy who's actually quite brilliant, but this brilliance is not going to get him very far in his current condition. He had a brain tumor many years ago, then a recurrence, and then a major brain bleed. And as a result of all of those things, plus radiation, he now has some memory loss. But he's also so defended, and he's competent, but his memory loops. It goes round and round. He's very defended because he was a man who was a neurologist who told people how to be healthy and what to do, and he's a researcher. So being around him now is a challenge. He does not want help. He thinks he does, but he does not want help. He wants the help of certain people, and he shuns the help of other people, which makes caregiving. So we put a caregiver in place. He is making this man's life miserable because he just doesn't want to be cared for. So now the caregiver called me up and he said, you know, my blood pressure is spiking. I can't keep doing this. And the point of that story is that he doesn't know how to accept help. He doesn't want help. So for the caregiver, the stress is three times worse. So we talk about let's talk about the signs and symptoms. Anxiety, depression, irritability, feeling tired, run down, difficulty sleeping, overreacting to minor nuisances, new or worsening health problems, trouble concentrating, feeling increasingly resentful, drinking, smoking, or eating more, that's my favorite, neglecting responsibilities, and cutting back on leisure activities. All of those things will cause a person to narrow down their focus, narrow down their lives, narrow down their thinking. And I think thinking is a large part of where caregiving, when you are narrowing your thinking, you don't have the ability or the will to see that there's more out there. So another example, there's a woman that I work with whose mother has dementia. And she's actually functioning reasonably well. Their budget is very tight because her mother, in a moment of whatever, many years ago, and this is where the discussion never happened between mother and daughter, spent all her savings. So now she does have a pension and she has Social Security and that's it. So whatever care she needs, she has to get within very, very narrow parameters. Whereas, had the discussion happened with her daughter, had the daughter thought to say, Mom, what are we going to do, as you get older, now those opportunities are foreclosed. There's no discussion. And so while she's at home, the daughter is a nervous wreck because mother doesn't want her, but nor is she doesn't have interest. She doesn't like to talk to her friends anymore. She goes out with certain people at certain times. She still likes to go with her daughter to have her nails done and her hair done. And the daughter is really burdened. She's a working woman, and she does not have siblings, and there is dementia in the family. And among the things that she is terribly frightened about, reasonably so, is that she could also acquire the illness. But she is truly totally alone with it. And she's alone with it because she won't seek help. So she came to the support group the other night, and the whole time the tears were just rolling slowly down her face. And she won't get help. There are certain things that she will do. She does have fun once in a while. But if you sit in a room and you cry for an hour and a half, that says there's something that's not happening. So we understand that?
Yes, we do.
Anybody feel overburdened? Yeah. Anybody taking care of more than one person?
Two.
Right. Parents?
Children.
Wow. So you know what it's like to feel that sense of being overburdened. So that's where hope and spirit come in, because you can keep your mind a little lighter. If you keep reminding yourself, there must be hope, there must be some help out there for me. So one of the things that we tell caregivers to do, and I want to tell you, nobody ever listens to this. So I'm going to tell you, and I gave you a handout. It's all written up here. I'm very proud of this because I put together what I thought were really good ideas. And then I looked and I said, nobody does this. Nobody does this. Nobody ever follows good ideas for how to be a good caregiver and how to avoid burnout. You're at risk for a lot of things. So what we are told is, don't let caregiving take over your life. That shouldn't be the only thing that defines you. It shouldn't be the only thing that you do in your life. It should be what you have to do, and it's to greater and lesser degrees depending on the kind of help that you have and what help you can get. But it shouldn't define you. However, there are people who want to be defined by their caregiving role. And maybe you know people like that. People who say, mommy wanted me to be the caregiver. Only mommy wanted me. No, nobody else. And then you've got the opposite of that is, my siblings don't ever call. They leave it to me. They say, whatever you want to do is fine. And they don't visit, and they don't talk, and they don't come, and they don't do. The other thing is people who feel they never had a role in life, and this becomes their job. Years ago, I worked at Memorial Sloan Kettering Hospital, and I saw parents taking excellent care of their children who were really quite critically ill. Some of the women I noticed were so invested in their roles as caregiving that when, for those who were fortunate and their children went home, they no longer had a role. They didn't know what to do with themselves. So the idea of making sure that your life is a little broader than your caregiving role is an extremely important one. You can't be defined solely by being a caregiver. You have to find other outlets, find other things to do. All your old hobbies, all your old friends, find ways to open up to that. Is anybody going to do that? One person raised their hand. I suspect you all do in various ways. Embracing your caregiver choice is kind of interesting. You don't have a choice. And you can keep fighting against it. I read an article, which actually years ago, I loved this article a lot. She said the woman, her husband, came down with a chronic illness and was very, very ill for over 20 years. And she said, her article was, I'm not the sum total of the, I am more than my hands. And she was a really, really angry woman, and with good reason, because she held the burden of their entire marriage, raising the children, taking care of a man with chronic illness for many, many years, and really didn't have the supports that she needed to have. And the tragedy of that is that, again, you isolate. But she wanted to be known as someone who worked very hard at helping her husband, and that she saw him through to his final days with grace. Get the appreciation you need. I wrote that. Get the appreciation you need. Do any of us get the appreciation that we need? Okay, so as a caregiver, you have the right to say, tell me how I'm doing. Likely is that if you're doing a good job, you're going to hear people say back to you, you're doing a very good job. This must be hard on you. Or what do you do for yourself? Remember when you took your kids to the doctor or you walked down the street and the doctor, everybody looks at the kid and the kid is so adorable and nobody ever looks at you? Well, chopped liver, shadow, gave birth to. So that's important. You have to be seen. Caregivers need to be seen. You don't have to be loud. You don't have to be the biggest and the best, but you have to feel acknowledged. And however you get that, whether it's within a small group of people or talking to friends or reaching out in a wonderful place like your church, you want to feel embraced by not only your community, but also to have them tell you what a good job you're doing. And by the way, one of the ways that I'm always saying to people when they say, I don't have anybody to help me, nobody to help me do the caregiving, have you talked to your church? Have you gone to a synagogue or a place of worship where maybe people there would be willing to help you? Maybe it's a phone call a week. Maybe it's a visit. Maybe it's just somebody who will help with transportation once in a while. But anything that helps to connect you to other people, and to and to continue connecting with your community, yourself, and your loved one. So there's a lot in here about asking for help. Here is also, I'm going to let you go through a lot of this on your own. Give yourself a break. Take one of the things we always say to people is take care of yourself. Go for a massage. Go do yoga. Well, here's the crux of really what I want to tell you. I save this. The truth of the matter is we are who we are. We come into caregiving with our own, with the personalities that we have. We're going to take as much as we want, and we are going to reject what we don't want. Sometimes that's for the good, and sometimes that's for the bad. There are caregivers, when we find caregiving is such a burden, we have to ask ourselves, is it really that much of a burden? Does it have to be? Am I doing enough to reach out and to get the help that I need? Because without that, it's a little bit of soul searching. What is my relationship with the person that I'm caring for? What's my stake in it? What do I want to get out of it? And don't think that we don't want something out of our actions. We do. We all do. We all want to know that we're appreciated and that somebody's going to pat us on the back and say, good job, great stuff, and all that's fine. I said that before. That's all fine. But if you're doing it for the wrong reasons, caregiving will be a burden. And if you don't soul search, you might not know how to go find the help that you need. You're a family with 5 kids in it, and you think you're the only one who will do whatever. And then you talk to, then somebody else talks to your siblings, and they say, well, she never asks. She tells us she doesn't need help. She tells us to go away. It's fine. Everything's fine. Because she holds the mantle of care. That is my job. That is my mission. And that's, again, it gets back to what's your health like? How's your health doing? How's your spirit? How's your interaction with the world? What's your life like? We have to ask that. What's your life like? If your life is going from a bedroom to a downstairs, into the kitchen, to the bedroom, to downstairs, to the kitchen, it's wearing. It can be very wearing. And if you don't get out of the house and don't do things for yourself, you end up as the martyr. And I guess there are people who still want to be martyrs, but it's not a good place to be. It's just emotionally and physically and psychically not a good place to be. Then there's the obligation. I feel obligated because I don't feel that I have choice. I feel obligated because people will think less of me if I don't. I feel obligated because this is what we do. I'm the daughter, and as we all know in this room, it's often daughters who are the major caregivers. Although I will tell you that as a result of the work I do and the support groups that I run, I've met some wonderful male caregivers. And they see life a little differently because men go out and they work and women are supposed to be home. We know that. Of course, it's a different world today, but I think we still hold on to the idea that we have roles and what are the obligations of a daughter? What's the obligation of a person, of any person, really? So that's another important idea to keep in mind. What is your obligation? Do you have an obligation to be the one and only? Do you have to be the only person who holds all the information? I work with a woman who said, second marriage for both she and her husband. She said, his kids don't do anything. I said, well, what do they know? They don't know anything. How come they don't know anything? They don't come around. Why don't they come around? It's a lot for me to entertain them. Why do you have to entertain them? Well, they're coming to my house. I have to make it, you know, we want to make it. That's our house. We entertain in our house. So even though you're talking about the care and tending of an ill person, somewhere we have rules. And that rule is for certain people, I can't invite people in unless things are perfect. So I said to her, how about sending out once in a while an email to all his kids and yours, how dad's doing? And I want to tell you that the minute she did that, life changed for her. There were more visits. There was a greater understanding. She also felt, because she was the second wife, she also felt that they were judging her. which gets back to obligation. I have to be the right one, I have to be the perfect one. And she came to learn that while they were all characters, but then who has a family that doesn't have characters? It defines my family. They all stepped up in various ways. Not always in the ways that she liked, which was irritating to her, but then that's caregiver irritation, really. Because when she stepped back from that, she realized that they were doing the very best that they could. And they really wanted to help her. So once she opened the door, she got a lot more help and understanding. And whatever the judgment was, once her kids and his kids understood the nature of his illness, they went, oh, okay, now we understand why she's doing that or that. And they were able to step in and say, well, I can do this part. So seeking help, asking for help, not isolating, share the wealth, ask for help. When you're being told that you're doing too much and you can't hear it, how about that? You know, you could get help. No, I can't get help. Why can't you get help? Because it's my job. Because I tried. There was nobody out there. So the woman that I was telling you about who's caring for her mother, when I initially started to work with her, she was no to everything. There's no agency out there. There's no nothing. And I started to give her resources. And I kept pressing, why don't you call this agency, try this agency. And she was able to patchwork together a lot more than she thought she was going to be able to do. But it took close to 6 months, 9 months, almost a year before she really embraced the idea that she did not have to be the only one. And that when people said to her, you're doing too much, she was then able to say, actually not, I'm sharing the load with. And we have to learn how to do that. Caregiving is not easy. Here's the last piece of information that I want you to think about. Anticipatory grief. From the minute a person is diagnosed with an illness that is a chronic illness, you know what the end will be. You don't know when, you don't know how, but you do know that it will happen. And from that moment forward, there is a pressure on your heart. And that pressure is the knowledge that no matter how hard you try to be the most perfect caregiver, you will not pull that person back from the brink. So anticipatory grief weighs heavily, and it's an undercurrent. It's a subtext. It's not loud, it's not big, it's just always there. And it can cause depression, and it can make you think, well, what's the point? And that's when you begin to, I encourage you to think about, yes, that's true, but we all are in a life cycle. And the anticipatory grief is part of someone else's journey as well. What are they losing? What changes are they experiencing? And as my specialty is dementia, I can tell you that that happens in jigs and jags, and that is by no means an easy process for a person with dementia. The idea that a person with dementia doesn't remember, so it won't matter. Yes, in the moment, they might not remember from day to day or from week to week, but rest assured, almost up to the last, people with dementia have a glimmering of awareness. And oftentimes, there was a woman in the support group the other night that said that her husband took a sudden dip, and he acknowledged it. And he really is a very confused man, but he acknowledged, he said, I'm just going downhill, aren't I? And indeed he was. So his sorrow starts. So the other thing we want is, let me get back there. Anticipatory grief. Does that make sense to you? Does it resonate? Does anybody ever feel, and are you aware, if you're caregivers, are you aware of that feeling? Yeah. So hold it. Hold the feeling and acknowledge it. And recognize that what that is just part of the cycle. It's intellectual at this point. We stand here, it's an intellectual exercise. But in the moment, you're you're looking at the person who needs their bed change, they have to get dressed, they have to be showered, they're yelling at you. You're not going to be thinking of anticipatory grief, you're probably yelling at them. Get up, do it, what are you doing? Why are you doing this to me? All of which is counterproductive, but nevertheless, in moments of frustration, and especially if you feel overburdened, you might yell and you might say things that you would rather not say, but nevertheless, that's human too. So anticipatory grief is part of the process. It is the underlying effect of an illness. It's something that both the person, everyone shares, but certainly the caregiver and the person who is being cared for share that. So what do you do with that? You just honor it, you live with it, and you recognize that, yes, their time will change. But once you're in the middle of the caregiving and you're saying, you're not eating, Mom, you're not drinking, Mom, what are you doing, Mom? Why don't you sit down, Dad? Go over there, Sonny. What are you doing? Maybe you want to change that around to, so tell me what happened when you were 13 and you ran away. I never heard that story, but Uncle so-and-so told me. I want you to tell me that story. And whether it's dementia or not, maybe you can get some other point of view of what who your family member is. And maybe it's a story that isn't even truthful, but doesn't matter. What you're doing is connecting on a different level. You're connecting on a life level. That's life. That's when, if I tell you my story, I'm telling you something that I want you to carry forth. Tell the kids. Tell the family. How silly was that I ran away at 13? I did run away, but I was much younger. I remember walking out of the house with my bag of dolls, and my father said, "Who's going to cross you?" And I stormed back into the house. I think I was 4. We all have stories, and if you've got nothing else in caregiving, you've got all the tasks and the rules and the things you have to do, and you have the financial burden, and you have a lot of things to sort out and work through. But one of the things you do have is that you are both people, you are all people with stories, and that I would encourage you to share. So I'm going to sum this up and then ask for your questions. Caregiving can be very, very burdensome. And if you find yourself slipping, find someone that's close to you that reminds you that there's a little bit more out there. Maybe what you need is just a prompt for someone to say, come on, just go take a walk with me. You know, you're getting too deep. You're worried too much. Mom does not need 3 blankets. Maybe she has only 2, and that'll suffice because she really isn't as cold as you think she is. Mom does not have to go to 3 different doctors for the same thing. And maybe she doesn't need to go to any doctors at all for a while because she's been to a bunch. Maybe what you want to do is engage with the family in ways that you can. They don't want to come to the house, so you send out an email or you send out a picture. Or instead of the holidays being exactly the way they used to be, that everything had to be perfect because Mom had it this way and she had it that way and she had it that way, you order in. You do something different. You do something that's more pleasurable. And you break the mold, you break the strain of thinking that you have to be a perfect caregiver. So that's it, isn't it? We've got a lot of things to think about. You've got the caregiver stress, and by the way, I didn't even talk about all the other responsibilities that can be burdensome until you figure them out. I would encourage you, however, to talk to your family about what it's like to be a caregiver, whoever you can find. I don't care, family could be extended, it could be friends. But talk about it, because the more you interact, the more you meet people who are sharing the same thing that you're sharing, which is why support groups are good. They break the mold, right? You want to get the help that you possibly can. Think out of the box. If you don't have if you're not a good creative person, talk to someone that you know that is creative. What can I do? Where can I find? Where can I go? Who do you know who might be able to help me? Keep searching, because the more you search, the more you'll be able to put together. When I talk to people in the support group, I am just amazed at the kinds of things that they find. Places to go where they can take their loved one. Facilities that they can go in for a day or for a week. Financial resources that I might not have known about that they found. There are all kinds of things that you find when you open up and share with people. So share the load, share the care. And remember that the journey is a life journey. It's something that we're all going to go through one way or another. So make it the best journey you can make it. So I'll take questions. Does dementia run in the family? I believe there's research that says yes. I don't want to say absolutely because I haven't read up on it recently. But I certainly do, I believe it does. But there are families who definitely have dementia with multiple family members. However, the cautionary tale is don't take that as everyone's going to get dementia because you've got somebody in your family that has dementia. Dementia is caused by many different things. It could be a stroke. It could be a bad fall. It could be medication. There are lots of reasons that people get dementia. The question was, what do you do with someone who doesn't want to accept help? So there's a concept called slow medicine, which was, you know, it makes perfect sense. And it's not something that if you're in the middle of caregiving today that you can embrace, but it is something for yourself and for the future. And that is, there was a doctor named Dr. Daniel McCullough who cared. He was obviously a physician, a geriatrician up in Boston, and he cared for his mother long distance. And what he did was to track her progress from the time she was in her 60s, 70s, 80s, and watch to see what her health was like and made accommodation each step along the way. Now, he's a nice boy, he's a doctor, she was willing to go along with that. Most of us end up with people who say, there's nothing wrong with me. So there are a couple of ways to handle that. One is you have a doctor tell your family member. First and foremost, let a doctor. Second, you have somebody else in the family or a good friend reinforce it. I see, no, Hazel, your memory is lousy. It's been lousy for a while. Listen to your daughter or listen to your son. You have to get people, that's another thing that, well, I'm saying it, but let me say it a little differently. You have to use the people around you. You cannot do it all. I worked at a day program, so I know what happens when people won't listen to a nurse. So another nurse came in, they go, oh, sure, of course I'll do it. Or a family member who says, she won't listen to me, he won't listen to me. Somebody else in the family or somebody, a good friend, may be able to break through and get them to listen to you. You just have to keep finding the way, and you have to be a little bit blunt. I just don't think you're as sharp as you used to be, and I want to help you now before it gets worse. And that might be a way to approach it. Is there a way to slow dementia down? Let me revise that. I said probably not. What I see are people who are, there are a couple of things that happen. In the early stages of dementia, especially people with Parkinson's disease, but definitely with dementia, they lose, it's a change in the brain. It's not something that happens voluntarily. They lose interest. So there's a woman in my support group that says, my mother used to play bingo all the time, and she used to do this, and now she won't do anything. And I keep telling her, go and do. She doesn't want to because she no longer has the connection to it. It's like people don't have the connection to want to see friends or family. So the answer to the question is, the earlier, especially with dementia, the earlier it's caught and diagnosed, the more time you have to get your person busy. A little bit of structure. You don't want to get them overly structured. You don't want life to be all about, you know, it's not a military base, but you want some structure, morning, noon, and night. You want to provide interaction with other people, whether it's a daycare or even a senior center. People can go to senior centers for a very long time and still enjoy activities, or they can enjoy music, or they can enjoy a dance recital. And it could be any place. But the more engaged you can get your person, get your family member to be, the better off you are and they are. So I work with a woman who is living in an assisted living. She's a very smart woman. She has a deficit that really works against her in so many ways. She lost hearing in her ear, the left ear, when she was 4 years old. 40% hearing in the other ear. And she walks around without her hearing aid. I say, what are you hearing? What? She actually does hear enough. She's a very, very bright woman. But she is a little bit bored because her hearing doesn't work in her favor. She doesn't remember names at all, so she's a little bit shy about interacting. But she is a very social person. She needs assistance to get out of her room. And what I've noticed is, and this is that with, I met with the staff along with her daughter, and we said, can you help her more? Because she really will sit in her room and she'll sleep. And you know that sleeping is a big part of what people do with dementia. Partly because the changes in the brain, I'm sure, affect sleep. I'm also sure that it's very difficult for people to stay focused and alert, and it's exhausting. Think about yourself when you're not on top of stuff and all you want to do is take a nap. Maybe not you, but me, you know? So in that regard, whether it doesn't have to be puzzles, it could be music. Music is a terrific way to access memory. It's a terrific way to energize people. It energizes us. You all love music. Everybody in this room loves music, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't hear that loud enough.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. What are the resources in Essex County for caregivers? I would refer you to Deb Day and the Caregiver Coalition, and we have a book that was put out that has tremendous amounts of resources. The resource manual. I would also suggest that you call Caregiver Coalition. Yeah. And there is also the county puts out a guide to all their services for senior services. You raise a good point, which is needing a living will. You need advanced directives, which are very explicit in telling the medical community what you do and what you don't want in the way of care, in the way of intervention. You need a living will, which is sort of the same thing, but it can be the advanced directive can be more detailed. You need to have a power of attorney for finance and for health. You need all those, and you need all those things. But to get people to the point to sit down and talk about them is often the hardest thing. Keep working at it.